19 minutes before 5, and you're listening to Radioactive on CBC Radio 1. The death toll from Typhoon Hagupit in the Philippines stands at 21. A Red Cross spokesman says 18 of the victims died on the eastern island of Samar. The typhoon hit the Philippines over the weekend. It's still moving through the region. Although deadly, Hagupit has been nowhere near as powerful as Super Typhoon Haiyan, which, as you may recall, tore through the central Philippines last November. More than 7,000 people died or are still missing. Richard Lote is with Shelterbox Canada. It's a relief agency helping in the Philippines right now. Hi there, Richard.
Good afternoon, Portia. How are you?
I'm doing fine. Why don't you tell us where you are and what it's like around you?
Yeah, so I'm currently in Cebu, which is just outside of where the typhoon hit the hardest. The response team got on the ground yesterday as Typhoon Ruby was wrapping up, and today, along with everyone else, I think people are venturing out from the evacuation shelters and now going to actually look at the extent of the damage. I mean, certainly, as you mentioned, it's very interesting because Typhoon Ruby here is really being looked at in the context of Typhoon Haiyan from last year, mm-hmm. and as a result, they didn't see, you know, the storm surges and things that came up last year. But despite having, you know, evacuated, you know, as many as 750,000 people to some of these evacuation centers, I think what's really going to become apparent in these next few days is just how much damage has been wrecked, because despite the people being saved, you know, their homes are still going to be destroyed when you get back to some of those coastal areas and where the typhoon hit land.
Right. So the emergency response was effective in that it got people to safe places, but there's no way of protecting their homes and their livelihoods. So what does it look like around you?
You know, Shelterbox has been on the ground since Haiyan, actually. You know, we specialize in, you know, the sharp end of the disaster, so that's getting on the ground within hours of, you know, a disaster taking place. But because every year we're coming to the Philippines multiple times, we started to work on developing programs with the people that allow them to build homes that are going to obviously sustain through future disasters. So having been here, we've noticed that, you know, the people are more prepared, which is great, because the big thing is that it's going to reduce the number of casualties. However, when you're getting out there, it's the same as it was last year. You know, I was one of the first teams in last year when Haiyan hit, and it's funny, in many cases, when you look at the landscape, you see all these coconut trees that look like they've just been sawn off with some sort of a machine gun, because with the, 150 plus, nearly 200 kilometer winds, it's like a giant blender, really, mm-hmm. that's just whipping debris around. And it's really sad, because these are people that can't go anywhere. They make their livelihood on the coast, and they have no choice but to put up with and then deal with it every year. And so certainly Shellbox is, we've got an established presence here. We've got thousands of tents ready to deploy and get to the people that need it as quickly as possible. And none of that's possible without the support of our donors across Canada and across the world who actually contribute to making the work we do possible.
Yeah, and so what are you giving them? You mentioned tents. What other essentials are you able to provide to people who've lost their homes?
So Shelterbox the shelter box itself is something that contains a tent, because we're shelter specialists, but within it we kind of have everything that, or as much as we can provide people to help bring kind of warmth, dignity, and the ability to get their life back on track after one of these natural disasters. So it includes everything from blankets, ground sheets, pots and pans, some tools which allow them to actually get out and start rebuilding a home, because what we do is, a relief option. We're not going out there and providing people something to live in for, perpetuity.
Yeah.
But rather, we want to actually support them in getting a home back together, because a tent's great, but that's not any way to, build a life when you don't have any rooms and you have no way of, going back to the way life was. So we've got about 400 shelter boxes in country, and then we also have what are known as shelter kits, which are a quicker relief method, tarps and the ability for people to rebuild some of their homes if they haven't been totally wiped out.
Yeah, with such great need, how do you decide who gets the shelter boxes, though?
We work with a number of different partners. many of the UN agencies that are on the ground, and collectively at the shelter cluster, we share information of where the greatest impact has been. And then once we get on the ground, we work very closely with the village leaders and the heads of the community to identify the vulnerable families. So people that have lost family members, child-headed households, pregnant women, single-parent families. So obviously we're getting into the most vulnerable individuals, and then we filter down from there to really people with totally damaged homes.
How are people doing, given that, from what I've heard, some there haven't even recovered from Haiyan yet? They're still trying to rebuild. A lot of people are. And then this comes along. Psychologically, how do people seem?
You know, that's really the big thing, is I think people were scared. You know, last year, Haiyan devastated the area. And people, it's not something you can prevent. You just have to live through it. And certainly people were really worried about what was going to happen. But I think the other thing, which is almost, you know, flown under the radar, is Legazpi, which was in direct path of Typhoon Ruby, was actually where Typhoon Glenda had hit earlier in July. So this is a community that, you know, not even 6 months ago was hit by a massive tropical storm typhoon, and they're still picking up the pieces from this year. So you can imagine, you know, the frequency at which they get hit, they almost don't have a chance to get back on their feet and get going, and that's why we come in and try to help get them through that, you know, short-term process and then help them rebuild for something longer term.
Yeah, and is the storm done now? What's happening?
Yeah, it's Tuesday morning over here in the Philippines, and For all intents and purposes, you know, the storm has passed, and I think now we're going out and, you know, the real assessments are going to begin. I mean, in that area, you know, eastern Samar and the eastern Visayas Islands, there's, you know, the Philippines is a massive archipelago, and so there's a lot of tiny, remote island communities that are difficult to get to, but they're the ones that really get wiped out. I mean, the typhoon hit, the coast along, a city called Dolores, and certainly that's been battered. But as it passed over, you know, the main part of the island, there's a number of smaller communities that get hit, and the extent of damage there isn't going to be known in the next few days, because it's going to take some time to get out there, boats. Mm-hmm. Boats that are seaworthy is certainly difficult given the battering they took with the storm.
Yeah, well, Richard, best of luck with all the work that you have ahead of you there. Thanks for speaking with us today.
Thanks a million.
That's Richard Lote with Shelterbox Canada. He's part of the response team in the Philippines providing aid to victims of Typhoon Hagupit or Typhoon Ruby.